Good afternoon to everyone. Welcome to this course. First, you know, we're going to work in these groups, okay? And the second thing that I want to know now is there anybody here who doesn't understand Spanish? Nothing of Spanish? Raise your hand. Everyone here understands Spanish? No, okay. Catalan? In English? Okay. Well, the course is announced in English, so I'll talk in English. But please stop me if you need something, if you have questions or whatever. We have three languages, more or less. So please, I think the languages shouldn't be a problem. So please stop me and tell me if you have questions or whatever. Okay, so this course is oral communication for scientific content, you know. And my first question is are you hungry? I am, because it's my lunch time. So I have a problem now, probably you too. And you know, when you eat something, sometimes you fell asleep after that, you know. So, why are you tired after eating? I don't know. Let me try to explain that. Well, this is because in your body, the collects tokinin, glucagon, and amylin are released to increase satiety. And also, because blood sugar rises and insulin is produced to allow the sugar to go from the blood into the cells. And serotonin then can lead to drowsiness, and melatonin, that is the other hormones that induces. Can someone stop me? Do you want me to keep reading? What happened here? Any ideas? It's okay. I can read. Melatonin is the other hormone that induces sleep and is not released due to the eating, but food does influence melatonin production. Nothing? Keep reading. We have 2 hours and a half. What happened? What happened with this slide? What happened? Okay, sleep. Don't sleep now. Wake up. What else? We are here to give a good presentation. It's boring. Okay, I'm not here to read. I can read. If I'm in this place, I can read. Don't read it for me. Why are you reading? What else? There's too much text. I don't need this text. What else? Nothing. We have a problem with this collect tokinin and glucagon and amylin and whatever. Hi, we're working. What else?
The images are very bad quality.
What?
The images.
Are very bad quality. Yeah, are pixeled. Everything is pixeled in this slide. The color is terrible also. What happened with the font? They are nice, this blue and then this red color there. Nothing. What else? Because you are focusing on the slide, but what happened with me? First, you are reading the slide, you are watching the slide, okay, and not me. But what happened with me? And I'm reading, and not a good presenter and not using my voice well and trying to grab the podium and moving my leg and looking at the slide, not you, many things. So this is a problem, and probably you experience this in any conference. How many times do you go to conferences and you can see that? A lot. So we have a problem, really a serious problem. Okay, don't worry, because we are here to avoid this. Okay, so don't worry about that. Okay, let me introduce myself just very briefly, because I think that this information is important for you, and especially to know what can I do for you in this case, for presentation. So I'm a researcher. I'm a Marie Curie Fellowship of the European Union. I have a contract with the European Union to do research here. I'm a visiting researcher at Indiana University and also at the University of California in Los Angeles. And here I'm a professor in the Department of Communication at UPF. I'm a PhD, I have a PhD in communication. I'm a specialist in voice. So this is really important. And gestures and posters and whatever. So second class will be, we're having fun in the second class. Working with our voices and, you know, pastors and jesters and these kind of things. I have a master in pathology of voice, so I can see if you have problems with your voice as well. I have a master in cognition and communication. I think that this is important, PhD in psychology. I work in the group of studies of prosody, so too much information, but the idea is that I work with speech from three different perspectives. Communication, linguistics, and psychology. You can find millions of blogs, webs, YouTube videos on the internet talking about oral communication, oral presentation, a lot of. But my point here is that I work with attention and memory. And because I work with attention and memory, this is important, because there are two main factors when you are delivering a presentation. First is the attention. If I don't have the attention of the audience, it's impossible that nobody understand anything, you know? So attention is a condition. It's a factor that is really important, and it's the first factor. So I'm here to try that you understand how people process messages, how people understand your presentation. Okay, and in this way, you will know how to deliver your presentation. That's the idea. Attention and memory, they're really, really important. Okay, the goal here in this class, probably you don't know, but is to prepare a competition. Do you know that? What competition is? Research in 4 minutes. These classes are to prepare this competition. So you will have to, to do it in the future. There is a competition called Research in 4 Minutes. I invented last year. Okay, that's okay. Please go with your group. So this competition is for presenting your research. But I have an assistant. It's called Mousy. Mousy is it. And Mousy has all the information.
Hi, I'm Emma's assistant. Here's what you have to do in this competition. You have to give a 4-minute presentation of the research you are doing for your doctoral dissertation. Committee will evaluate you based on the academic significance, clarity of expression, and your ability to convey your project holding the attention of the audience. Is it clear?
Is it clear? Okay. This is the competition, and this is the goal of the competition. Okay. Well, I hope that you never have this situation. Read it. Read it. No, the second. The second one. The first one is okay. But read it first. Is it familiar? So even if you plan and prepare everything, many things will happen. It's for sure. So my advice here is you have to prepare everything, of course. Many things will happen, but less if you prepare, if you thoroughly prepare and plan all your presentation. My advice, and especially for this competition, is you have to write every word you say, every word. Even good afternoon, good day, good morning, whatever, hello, whatever, every word. And I'll explain why. But you have to plan and prepare everything. We don't have many good presenters just for this reason, because people think, well, I can talk. I can talk and go there and explain what I do, because I'm the specialist in this topic, so it's okay, it's fine. I go and talk. No, this is not the idea, okay? And this is not the idea here in these classes. So we are here to you, or for you to learn, or to learn and to acquire communication skills in this case. But the problem here is that there are communication skills but applied to scientific content. The problem with scientific content is like the problem that we have journalists. I'm a journalist. I worked for many years in the Cadena Ser in Madrid, presenting news on the bulletins every hour. And what happened in this case? That you are in a bubble. This is the journalist syndrome. I call it the journalist syndrome. The journalist syndrome is that you are in a bubble. You know everything because you are managing information every day and writing all the information, and you know you have this level of information. But what happened with your audience? They don't have this level of information. They have this level of information, but you are, but on the opposite, you are telling news or whatever, in this level of information, okay? And there is a problem, because nobody understands you, and probably you experience that when you are watching television and news or listening to the radio, and you hear all this technical vocabulary or legal vocabulary, and you don't understand anything. So, scientists is the same. You are in your lab, close, in a bubble, with your information, with your topic. You know everything about your topic, but your mother, what happened with your mother? She doesn't know about your topic. She can't understand your topic. You know, and you think when you are presenting something in, I don't know, in a conference, you think unconsciously that everyone there knows, has the same level of knowledge. It's not true. And this is the problem. This is a problem, finally, because comprehension is bad, attention, I'm boring, I don't know what you are telling me, so this is a problem, okay? Here we have to combine two things, communication skills with scientific content, and also you have to be a little bit attractive. Majority of science talks are really boring and really bad. Many presenters are bad, so we have an advantage here. We have a hope. We are okay because, well, we can find these kind of things. Okay. Let's start watching this video. This video is a presentation of last year's. It's one student who participated last year in this competition in Research in 4 Minutes. He won the second prize. Okay, good. And what I like to do is to watch this video you have here some sheets, worksheets. So take one and just write, after watching the video, what do you think that are the main aspects that you have to take into account in a presentation, in an oral presentation, okay? So watch this video, think about what are the main aspects, what are the important aspects in a presentation, and then just write these ideas, okay?
Continuem amb l'Álvaro Castells i el títol de la seva comunicació és Dinàmica de l'RNA usando microscopia de alta definició.
Hola, buenas, soy Álvaro Castells y vengo a presentar mi tesis viendo cosas muy... Uy, esto está mal. Ahí. Hola, buenas, soy Álvaro Castells y vengo a presentar mi tesis Dinámica del RNA usando microscopía de alta definición o, dicho de otra forma, viendo cosas muy pequeñitas mejor que antes. Desde siempre, los biólogos hemos intentado entender cómo funciona la vida, los procesos fundamentales de la misma, pero esto ocurre a una escala muy, 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 muy pequeña. Hemos tenido que desarrollar herramientas para poder verlo, la microscopía. El problema que tiene la microscopía, o al menos la óptica, es que tenemos lo que se viene a llamar un límite de resolución. Un tamaño a partir del cual no podemos bajar más, no podemos ver dos puntos que estén más juntos de eso. Que en este caso es 200 nanómetros, que vendría a ser pues un centímetro, lo partimos en 10, un milímetro, lo partimos en 10, lo volvemos a partir en 10, lo partimos en 5, y ahí ya más que eso no podemos ver. Hasta ahora, que han empezado a surgir nuevas técnicas de microscopía, llamada microscopía de alta definición, que nos permiten bajar más aún. Pasamos de tener 200 nanómetros a tener 20 nanómetros. ¿Qué efectos prácticos? Algunos diréis, bueno, no es tanto, ¿no? 200 a 20, pero vamos a poner un ejercicio, ¿no? Imaginemos que aquí en la X tengo un virus. Aquí. ¿Lo veis? No, porque es pequeñito. Pero si tuviésemos un microscopio, lo que podríamos ver, seríamos, ya empezaríamos a ver algo, ¿no? O sea, los de ahí atrás podéis ver un puntito, podéis ver algunas cosas, pero aún no lo tenéis muy claro. Pero si ahora aumentamos un orden de magnitud, que es lo que podemos hacer con Storm, y esto está a escala, ¿eh?
Pasamos a tener
ya una cosa que podemos ver, podemos distinguir, sabemos, oye, pues ya podemos empezar a estudiar, ¿no? Entonces, eso es lo que estamos básicamente haciendo yo. Explicándolo un poco mejor, ¿vale? Lo que hacemos es coger unas cosas que brillan y las pegamos a lo que queremos ver. Pasa que en vez de brillar, lo que hacen continuo es parpadean. Entonces, pillaríamos unas, luego habría otras que parpadearían, luego habría otras, y luego cogemos todas esas y las juntamos. Entonces tenemos una imagen muchísimo más definida que lo que teníamos si brillasen todos a la vez, que habría un borrón de color. A efectos prácticos lo que tenemos, esto es por ejemplo resultados de mi laboratorio, aquí tenemos, vemos un núcleo de una célula, arriba con microscopía de alta definición y abajo normal. Cuando hacemos un zoom vemos que podemos seguir distinguiendo muchas cosas en alta definición, mientras que normal básicamente es nada, lo que podemos, información que podemos sacar de ahí. Entonces yo lo que estoy haciendo es viendo el RNA. Para que nos entendamos, si el DNA es lo que lleva la información del cuerpo y la proteína es lo que hace la función, el RNA es el que hace el mensajero entre la información y la función. Y esto es lo que estoy obteniendo. Estas son imágenes mías del RNA total de la célula, visto en microscopía de alta definición. Podemos ver aquí núcleos generales, sirvo en zoom, y a pesar de que estamos haciendo zoom, seguimos viendo muy bien lo que hay ahí. Entonces, hasta ahora no se había conseguido tener ver RNA con esta capacidad de resolución tan pequeño, tan claro, a microscopía óptica. Y preguntaréis, ¿por qué? O sea, ¿para qué nos sirve esto? Vale, pues hasta ahora el RNA se ha estudiado mucho, ¿eh? Es cierto, se ha estudiado mucho. Pasa que se ha visto cantidad relativa que hay. Hay más, hay menos, no hay, hay. O si interactúa con algo, vale, interactúa con proteínas, hace cosas, pero no teníamos los medios de estudiar cuál era la estructura general del RNA, cómo se distribuye el RNA dentro del núcleo. Y sobre todo, lo que queremos hacer nosotros es ver cómo esa estructura se ve alterada por diferentes procesos celulares. Células en diferentes situaciones, haciendo diferentes cosas, van a tener una estructura de RNA diferente. Y podemos aprender mucho sobre esto si podemos ver aquí. Asimismo, también queremos ver, ahora que por fin podemos ver tan abajo, ya no solo la estructura general, sino las cosas que forma el RNA. Porque, por ejemplo, aquí estamos viendo que claramente aquí hay una distribución diferente que el resto. Y aún no sabemos muy bien qué pueden ser estas cosas. Bueno, algunas sí, otras no, son diferentes cosas que estamos viendo. Entonces, pues básicamente esto es. Espero tener resultados pronto y muchas gracias.
Okay, share with your group the ideas and then you can write. 5 minutes to do it. Sorry, Sara, it's in Spanish. Just talk about the non-verbal language. You can talk. Ideas. This is called oriented attention. Okay, ideas. What are the main elements that we have to consider in a presentation? Number one of the group, for example, two? Who is number one here? Ah, nobody knows. It's Maria. No. Number two, I said. It's Cristina. Who is Cristina? Hi, Cristina. Can you please go to the podium, Vera? Because I can hear you.
Hello. Do I have to present myself?
No.
Okay.
Just share the ideas.
Just in case. We think that one of the main things that we have to do in a presentation to be good is to how to module our voice, how to talk, if it's low or it's louder, or how to end the sentences, how to start the discourse and end the discourse according to our voice, to redirect what we want to say and to emphasize the elements that we want to emphasize for you to understand our presentation.
Okay, perfect. Another idea. For example, in group C's, number 3 is Irene. Irene is here? No. Irene? How come here? This is for the second class, but so don't worry now about how you go to the podium.
One of the ideas that we had also is that we have to match our speech and vocabulary to the audience's knowledge.
Speech and vocabulary.
Yeah.
Content.
Content, yeah.
Perfect. And in group 8, 10, Lara. Who is Lara? So, Lara, 3 ideas. Voice, content, and third one?
So, hi.
You will practice this path to the podium in the second class. Don't worry.
So, we think that it's very important to have a good structure. Like, you need to... like to have a story that you want to tell, so you can follow like a story and yeah, have a good structure, basically.
Okay, perfect, thank you. I miss one point, one aspect. We have voice, we have content and structure, and what else? What? The picture, the presentation, the stage. The slides, I don't know, many things. So, yes, we can divide the main aspects in a presentation in these 3 parts. The first one is? Well, the first one before the presentation is the content, data selection, data structure, you know? Second one is the form, the nonverbal communication, nonverbal language, the gestures and the voice. And the third one is the scenery, the stage, time, especially control of time, the space. I'm gonna give you this presentation, Mark, so you don't have to. I'll give you everything, so don't worry. Just listen to me. The scenery is supporting materials, space, time, these kind of things. Okay? These are the 3 classes that we have. First one is for content. The second one will work about the form, nonverbal language, confidence, and whatever. And the third one is about the support materials, time, these kind of things. PowerPoint, death of PowerPoint, these kind of things. This is the third one. So, don't miss any class, because if you can't come here, so we won't get the whole information. We miss one special important part, because 3 parts are really important, okay? But today we're focused on the content. I'm sorry, this is the hardest class I know, because content is complicated in this sense, more than voice, more than support materials, you know? But is really important. And we have to work with data selection and data structure, especially. So, perfect the ideas, we have to structure the information. Summary for today, Little Onion can tell us.
So here we go. This is the summary for today. How do people perceive What is your goal? How your audience is? What information are you going to present? How are you going to structure this information? What kind of languages are you going to use? What rhetorical devices are you going to use?
Easy. This is what we are going to work today. Perfect. And we have to start, we are going to start for attention, because attention is really important, you know. Many of you have written something about attention, catch the attention, attention, attention is important. So let's watch this video, and the idea is to know how attention works.
I'm going to show you something that's not completely legal.
Happen to notice all the things that have changed since the scene began.
Action.
I'm going to show you something that's not completely legal.
Go. Here.
While we held your attention on the money, the table turned to a stool.
Go.
Apollo magically got a new hat and handkerchief. And all the posters and cards in the background changed.
Your brain just played a trick on you. We all think we're paying close attention to the world around us. But strange as it may sound, this is just an illusion.
Go!
Misdirection is an elegant form of attention control. Our brains only allow us to really focus on one thing at a time. So when we have you deciphering a mystery down here, another mystery can be happening back here.
So, did you miss the 8 things that changed throughout the scene? Don't feel bad if you were fooled. Since you can't pay attention to everything at once, your brain has to prioritize what's most important. Attention is like mental money. And psychologists like Dan Simons know your brain has to choose carefully where to spend it.
Attention is what we focus on in our visual environment. It allows us to select some aspects of our world to be seen and others to be ignored or filtered out of awareness.
For over 20 years, Simons has been studying the brain's inability to keep track of changes, a concept known as change blindness.
Change blindness is the failure to notice surprisingly large change from one moment to the next. When we look at our world, we take in a far smaller subset of it than we think we do, and that's because attention is limited. We can really only focus attention on one thing at a time. And that thing is what we really process in a lot of detail and become aware of.
At this moment, you may feel like you're taking in everything that's happening in front of you, but you're not. Stare at the poker chip again. While you're looking at it, are you giving any thought to the wall color of the room you're sitting in? Or where your hands are placed? Your brain runs on just 12 watts of power. Less than a third the amount your refrigerator light bulb uses. With such limited energy, your brain is hardwired with countless shortcuts to essentialize the world. Since it can't begin to process everything around you, it's evolved to focus in on what counts.
Okay. So share with your group the main ideas, and you can write again. What is this important for your presentation? 2 minutes. Over. In group one, Jesus? That's not here. In group three, Victoria? Can you go to...
Hello.
Hi.
What we were discussing with our group, that we learned that our brain can only focus on one thing.
More intensity.
More intensity. That our brain can only focus on one thing, and we need to be really careful where we want the audience to focus, where to drive their attention.
Perfect. This is the main idea. Thanks. What is the main idea here? What? The what? Ah, no. What happened here? Disconnected things, many things at the same time. I can process it. This is a good question. But probably, if I do that, let me put this. It's okay. Sorry, I can put the table. And now? Are you processing well? Okay. This is for the babies that are inside. It's okay. It's easy to understand. I can have any effort to process that. But if you do that, and you are talking at the same time, and you are reading the slide, and I have a slide there, but I'm moving now, but I'm doing that with my leg, and at the same time I'm doing... it's like, I can process that. So please, is the main idea in this case is 1 point at a time. 1 point at a time, always. So at any time in your presentation, you have to think in about what is the main point. You are focusing the attention, orient the audience just on 1 point in this second, and the other minute is for another thing, and so on. Now my presentation is in black because I'm the protagonist now. And I will show you a way to do it, very easy, to put a slide in black, because now the attention is here. And I have, my job here is to orient the attention of the audience. That's the idea. 1 point at a time. Don't forget that idea. This is really important. Okay. Because multitasking is a myth, you know. This is not true. Many studies are saying the same, are showing the same. It's not possible to write an email while I'm watching a movie. You can do the same, the two things at a time, but my brain is not focusing on these two things. It's just selecting, it's alternative. My attention is selective. So now it's here, and then it's here. But at the same time, it's impossible. So probably you won't know anything about the movie because you are writing an email. The email probably had mistakes with the grammar because you are watching in the other moment of the movie, so many kind of problems. Multitasking is a myth. So, and this is a rule. After 10 minutes of your presentation, the attention still drops. Here you can see it. Steadily drops. What happened here? You have just 4 minutes in this competition. On probably in your conferences, you have 15 minutes, 20 minutes, about this time. What happened when I have less time than 10 minutes? So if I have a 4 minute presentation, the idea is that attention could drop 2 minutes, inside 2 minutes. So be careful where after 2 minutes, okay? If it's 15, 20, my recommendation is to divide your presentation in chunks, 4 chunks, so 5, 5, 5, and 5. And the idea is that, well, to think about that also. If your audience is a non-expert, the attention of non-expert drops at 2 minutes, after 2 minutes. If it's an expert and know anything about your job, it's about 5 minutes. So this is a problem. At any time, if it's 2 minutes, if it's 5 or if it's 10, at this time you have to do something emotionally relevant, something. What can I do? After 2 minutes, or after 5 minutes, or after 10? If you are you teachers? Are you giving classes? Think about that, especially if you have a class of 1 hour, every 10 minutes you have to do something different. Something very different, strongly different. And then mini calls of attention every 2 minutes, 5 minutes, depends on the length, okay, the total length. But 10 minutes, it's very, we have to pay attention to these 10 minutes. What can I do to regain the attention? What? Ask questions. But if I have a presentation of 15 minutes in a conference, this is complicated. Change? I can change the tone of my voice. I can change the intensity of my voice in one moment, for example. What else? Put an example. We have a lot of resources, of content, of form, of material, whatever. Change the slide, put a video, put a sound, change your voice, sit down or stand up in this moment, move around, do something. But do something, please. Okay. And this is important as well. Attention works with variation, contrast. If I'm talking in this way during all the class and for example, sitting there and I can move and do anything, and this is boring. I need contrast. I need variation. So something different. But comprehension works in a different way. Comprehension needs logic, needs structure, needs patterns. So we have to combine these two main concepts. On one hand, I have to do something different every 2 minutes, every 5 minutes, every 10 minutes, okay? But at the same time, I need to structure my discourse in a logical way, because if not, I'm lost. But the audience is going to lose all the information. It's like you are like a guide, and I can say, well, come with me. Take my hand and come with me. And first, we're gonna visit this table, okay? This table is table number 2, okay? So, it's okay for you?
Yes.
Does it make sense? Okay, and now we're gonna hear, because I buy this bicycle. This is a structure. This is logical thing. You have to take the hand of your audience. and do something like that. Okay, and we don't pay attention to boring things. So please, don't bore me. This is the idea. What is your purpose in your presentation? I know. Everything is about the goals, it is the purposes and whatever. I know, but if you don't go, if you don't know where you go, you won't get it. It's very clear. So, and I think that because I read the outline forms, your outline forms, and I think that this is not very clear. This is my opinion. So, what is your purpose when you are doing a presentation? Who? What? To share information. Okay, to give information, to give a presentation, to this kind of thing. No, this is not my goal. My goal is not to go and present all the information because I'm really a wonderful scientist and I know everything about the topic and I'm very good and I have to show my intelligence because I work a lot of hours in this project and I know everything. And just for that, you... No. This is not your goal. Nobody thinks in person, in people, in your mother. Nobody. And the goal is always result-oriented. If you are teachers, when you are filling out your syllabus, please think in your students. The goal is not to, I don't know, to study I don't know what. This is not the goal. The goal is that your student have to know, have to learn, have to acquire I don't know what. So, put in the place of your student, put in the place of your audience. So this is the main question that you have to think when you are preparing your presentation. What will the listener end up knowing about your research? That's it. So result-oriented, okay? So this is why you have an outline form saying what is your contribution. Because I'm not doing a research if there is not a contribution. I'm not, the public government is not funding something if there is not a contribution. If you are not thinking in people, about what people need in this case. No? Here is the problem. I'm a researcher, and I'm doing a research about mitochondria. This is my slide to start my presentation. What do you think? Engaging? No? It's very clear, I think. It's nice. Someone can be involved in this slide in some manner? No, so this is not my point. This is not the idea. Probably I'm really a good specialist in mitochondria, but this is nothing for my mother. This is nothing for me. I'm a by working communication. What's that? I don't know. But what happens if I tell you that mitochondria are giving you the energy to move your body and that mitochondria are really important when you are working out? And these are important, and this is my work, this is my research, because for obesity, the function of mitochondria are really important. Better? Okay. My research is the same. I'm a specialist as well. But now the point is on you, not on me. I'm not the protagonist here. You are the protagonist here. So this is the point. I prefer this slide. And especially if you do that in an attractive way, better, with a smile and whatever, okay? So this is the idea, with the purpose. The audience, who is the audience? I need my assistant again.
What I can read on the website is that the jury of each session will consist of 3 members. Remember, 3 members to be chosen among researchers, teaching staff, postdocs, alumni, administrative and service staff. So, everyone in the university.
This is the jury for the competition. But if you think in your audience when you go to a conference, my experience during 20 years is that you have people from everywhere, and probably they are not specialists in your specific topic. My experience, for example, in communication, this is horrible because you go to a conference of communication, and communication is everything. Everything. And you can find anyone who do the same as you is really complicated. I don't know if in biology, linguistics is the same, law probably the same. So, what is your audience? So, of course, teachers, of course, researchers, of course, doctoral students, students, in general, people. In general, I think the frog. Think in the frog, if you want. Because it's very complicated to find a specialist like you. You are the specialist in your topic. So please think on that. Your audience, when you think in your audience, you think that it's the ideal audience is alert, is fresh, is prepared to hear what you have to say. They know everything about your topic. Even they read your paper. But no, this is not true. This is your audience. And I really don't know why I'm here. I'm tired, I'm hungry. A disaster. Think in your mother or think about this monkey, because this is your audience. Okay, your mission here is to wake them up, because probably they are very tired, they are thinking about beach and I don't know, many things. How many things I have to do? So this is your mission, to wake them up and especially make them glad they did. Okay, the topic. The topic is really complicated. But in any research, you have a problem. We have a problem. All of us have a problem, and you have the solution. If you don't have a problem, why are you doing a research? I'm very sorry, but I have just one outline form answering me what the problem is. The problem is not the problem is not a question, and it's not your goal. The problem is a problem. What happened with, I don't know. For example, many people are bored in the presentation because many presenters read their slide. Okay? Well, so there is a problem because these people can't understand what you are saying or whatever. We have problems with comprehension, we have problems with the processing information and so on. And I'm doing a research about trying to check different ways to present the information, for example, with a picture, with just a sentence, what happened with attention and what happened with comprehension in this situation. This is my solution. My solution is, of course, the result is that you can write a lot of words, you can just use a picture. I have the results. This is my solution. So what is the problem is clear, and this is my solution, and I'm doing research for that. Clear? So you are scientists, and please don't tell me, no, I'm working in, it's hard, well, it's a pain for me when someone tell me, well, no, I'm not a biologist or a medic. This is typical. I'm working communication, or I'm working linguistic, or I'm working law. No, I haven't a methodology. What? You don't have a methodology because you are working in, I don't know what. No, we are here and we are, everyone here are scientists. And the scientist method is the same for all of us. And especially, believe me, when you have to try to get funding for your research, when you are trying to sell, because you are selling your papers to the journals, to the main journals, when you are trying to get money for I don't know. You have to explain that in a very easy way, and you have to make clear what the problem that you are trying to solve is. Because if people can see this problem, why they will give you money for that? So think about that. So we have a problem, and make clear from the beginning that you have a problem, or we have a problem, and you have this solution. And this problem is really interesting, and of course affects people or animals or whatever, okay? This is the most important thing at the beginning of your presentation. Make clear what the problem is, okay? And you have the solution, of course, because if not, you are not doing research. So you have the solution. Probably you don't have now the solution, but when you will do all the research, your dissertation, you will have the results. Okay, so you will have the solution. It's, of course, a rigorous solution, methodical solution, and if, of course, the solution is for people, helps people. Right? So far, so good? It's hard to think in these terms, but believe me, it's the best way to start your careers as a scientist. Probably if you are working in biomedicine, of course, the main, it's true, it's really easy to see this structure in biomedicine or in biology or in medicine, in science in general, because, well, you are working with your body, it's easy to understand, but please, the rest of disciplines, try to think in these terms as well. If you want to get funding for Europe, of Europe or whatever, it works in this way, so. Okay, clear the problem and clear the solution. Is it clear? So we have a problem, 1 plus gram equals 3. What is the solution? A condom. Okay, when you are selecting your data for your presentation, be careful. Less is more. So just take one part of your presentation. If it's for this competition, it's just 4 minutes. So please just select one part. One part that means not, oh, my whole research with all the variables that I'm running and all the, I don't know, I'm running three different experiments. No. One experiment or one variable or one thing, just one thing. So less is more. It's like a miniskirt. Should be like a miniskirt. So short enough to raise expectations, but long enough to cover the main part. So this is the idea, a mini skirt. Not too much information. You know, many of you have written about the too much information in the presentation of the guy, you know, the student. Not too much information, I'm very clear. Select, I don't know, the part of your research that are more interesting, more attractive, whatever. Something easy to understand, that's the idea. So what's the main point I want to make to my audience? In this case, this part of the heart, but not everything, got everything. So I don't want to know about the background, the frugal system, the shortcomings of frugal, the overview of synthetic epimorphins, the reducible deductible of the pseudocluric fragment, the technical details of the related work. I don't want to. Nothing about this, unless if you have 4 minutes. In 4 minutes is really fast, so nothing about that. Even in a conference, if you are giving a talk about 15 minutes, forget it. Forget everything. The structure. The structure is really important, you know, and this is the structure of a presentation. We have an introduction, we have a development, and we have a conclusion. This is easy to understand because if you are telling a story, it's the same. For this competition, you have 4 minutes. So introduction should be about 1 minute, 1 minute and a half. But even when you have a longest presentation, better 1 minute and a half, 1 minute, the introduction, very easy, very clear. The development, the middle, so it depends on the length, but 3 minutes in the case of this competition. And in the conclusion, 30 seconds. No more than 30 seconds. The beginning. What happened in the beginning? Let's tell you something about the beginning. You know that in the first 10 seconds, people decide if they don't like you. Just 10 seconds. In 20 seconds, people decide if you are competent in this topic. 20 seconds. And in the next 10 seconds, that's it, 30 seconds, they decide if your presentation is or not interesting. So, I like you, 10 seconds. You are competent, 20 seconds. And, well, you are telling me it's interesting, 30 seconds. Just 30 seconds. So, the beginning is really important. In my opinion, it's the most important thing in your presentation. Well, at the beginning, you know, I'm Emma, introduce yourself, say hello, these kind of things. My recommendation is not to introduce yourself and not the title of your presentation. For this competition, you have just 4 minutes. In 4 minutes, it's impossible. You are wasting your time if you are trying to start saying, well, I'm Emma and I'm going to talk about, I don't know. Because I'm wasting my time. In four minutes, it's impossible. But you have a presenter. You have always a presenter saying, well, this is Emma, and this is from the department, I don't know where, and the presentation is titled, I don't know. When you go to a conference, it's the same. You have a chairman presenting you. So why are you wasting your time saying, I'm Emma? Because, you know, finally, when you are in the question time, how many times you heard this? I have a question, but I don't know the name of one, two, the third in the table. How many times? Many times. Nobody remembers your name. It's too much information, and your name is not relevant in this case. So my advice is just to put up a slide, the first slide with the title and your name, but don't say it. People can read, don't say it. Just put the slide, wait, and when you start, you change the slide. For this presentation, for this competition, my idea is to put a standard slide for everyone, so don't worry about the first slide. Just start directly with the attention getter, and the problem and the solution. In the introduction, first, you have to start with the attention getter. It's easy to understand what it is. And the problem explanation, okay? So, attention getter, problem to solve, significant for people, solution you propose, and your goal. In 1 minute. It's a little bit hard, but no, don't worry. Attention, get up.
I hate you.
Something different, something new, something whatever. So I want ideas about that. How can I start in a very surprising way, in a very different way, my presentation? You can work with your group. Thank you. Who has a very suppressive idea, different, completely different idea? Than the typical? Hi, I'm Emma, I'm gonna talk about... Nobody? Your name?
Herboye.
Herboye. Herboye. Nice name. Okay. I've never heard it. Okay, an example, you said? Okay, I did it. Mm-hmm. Perfect. More ideas? Mm-hmm. Great. Another one? Asking a question, yeah, asking something, a rhetorical question or a question in general. There are many things that you can do, many things. So you have a lot of options. I have here one of tell a story, an anecdote, an experience, rhetorical question, a question, and a statement, for example, at the beginning, or quotation, humor, suspense, a game, surprising statistics, data. I don't like humor, especially at the beginning. If you're a clown with your friends and you are really funny, I don't know, but this is not my recommendation. At the beginning is the worst. It's the worst because you have to break the ice. You have the audience here in this way, expecting. So if you tell a joke, and this joke doesn't work, run. So don't do it, especially at the beginning. Then in the development, you see that, well, the audience is really bad. It's okay. With you, okay, probably it's okay, but not at the beginning, please. So you have all these options and more.
If you've ever seen a human brain, it's obvious that the two hemispheres are completely separate from one another. And I have brought for you a real human brain. Yes. Thank you. So this is a real human brain. This is the front of the brain, the back of the brain with the spinal cord hanging down. And this is how it would be positioned inside of my head. And when you look at the brain, it's obvious that the two cerebral cortices are completely separate from one another. For those of you who understand computers, our right hemisphere functions like a parallel processor, while our left hemisphere functions like a serial processor. The two hemispheres do communicate with one another through the corpus callosum, which is made up of some 300 million axonal fibers. But other than that, the two hemispheres are completely separate.
This is an idea. But if you don't have a real brain, I have my walking brain as well. When I'm going to a presentation and talk about the brain, I can put this walking brain, and it's funny, and well, it walks, okay. You can use objects. People like objects. I don't know, you don't have exactly the object, but you can go to the Chinos or the Pakistanis or whatever. You can find everything there. Toys are really useful as well. I don't know. Or you can do something to show, I don't know, an idea. I don't know. I can do many things with my body and moving. But objects are really clear. Next week, I can show you something else about that. But think about objects.
Thank you.
you have to know where you are, of course. If you are in a tech talk, you are talking to everyone, so you need to be really clear. If you are in a conference that is specific about your topic, you can do other things, but do other things. I can tell you my experience. Always people remember my presentation and not the others. And I go to, even when I go to a presentation that is specific of my topic, I can do many things to, because, you know everything about your topic. You can think in something different that people don't know or people don't think about it. Do you know what I mean? Does it make sense, what I'm trying to say? Even when I talk for someone that, for example, I work with sound, imagine. So I'm a voiceover, better. I'm a voiceover. Now, in March, I have to go to Atlanta to give a presentation for voiceover of the United States. Okay, to train voiceovers. You know what a voiceover is? Voiceover, for example, and the voice of Levi Strauss in Spain. And when you call to Levi Strauss, it's me saying, hey, hello, what are you doing? So these kind of things. When I put my voice for advertisement or these kind of things, this is a voiceover, the voice that you hear in advertising or in your phone calls or, okay. So even when I go to this specific area, I can surprise them with many things. Like, for example, a very bad ad, for example, on radio. For example, what I do, it is another resource for the third class, is to prepare the stimuli. You are doing your stimuli as well. So I prepare, I record, for example, people saying something. Tell me, record with my phone. You don't need a microphone or something special. So, for example, say, tell me, I don't know what. And because I work with prosody and intonation, probably this person that doesn't know about prosody will do very bad. And I have my example. And I go, and this is the first sound that I can hear, and we can analyze many aspects. So even when you have expert person, expert people in front of you, you can do it. You can think about one thing. For the next class, give us, tell us in the next class, one of your topic, one research that you are doing. And we can think all together something different to start. For a specific people. How many people use sound in your economy? One idea. Start with a sound. Yeah, you have the possibility all over the world because you always have a computer, someone that is asking you what do you need for your presentation, and if not, do you know what I do? I go with my computer, with my headphones, with my with speakers, with everything. I have this speaker. It is small. I go with it everywhere, and I put the sound. Because when you go to a conference, rooms are really small, so you can use that. It's okay. If you are the best presenter, the main presenter, the main speaker, you have everything. This is my experience. I go to Atlanta, I go to Paris, and everything is, well, what do you need? I need sound, I need video, I need many things. And try it. If you do something different, if nobody uses sound, and for example, you have a problem in your research, explain us what is the problem of your research, what you are researching. Okay, stop. Record to your grandmother saying that, and start with that. Don't explain you. It's your grandmother who is explaining.
It's not only about ecology, but Helena is talking about, it's really about norms that exist in certain disciplines, and in economics, it really is like that, that if you violate these norms, people are going to think less of you. And you don't want to, especially when you're a young researcher, I'm not really sure that you want to violate the norms.
What? These norms are written?
No, they're not, but still they exist.
Yeah. I agree.
So in research, we are looking at or aiming at something really new, the quality, of course.
Of course.
If we are forgetting this goal by dragging people's attention, wouldn't that be negative?
Yeah. But the problem is that the perception of people is not that. Form. Is not the form that you are using is accomplishing, is with your content. So people are deciding if you are competent, not just for the content, mainly not for the content. So if you are bored, you are boring. I can hear you. So it's a question of attention. It's the same what you are telling me, and. I would like to, this is my experience, but try it. Try to do something, maybe if there are rules. There are no rules when you are presenting, or you are a good presenter or you are a bad presenter, and you can get the attention or not. This is the only thing here. It's not a question of the content or the discipline. It's just how can I explain to you that in a very easy and attractive way. Easy is about the content, attractive is about the form. So, if you have these strong rules, or many people that are really boring, or doing nothing. So what do you think when you are listening to that? What do you think when you are listening to that? Do you like it? So you are answering the question in the sense that it's your experience, and your experience is not different from other people because people are the same. We are the same. In terms of cognitive processes, we are the same. We are working in the same way. So it's your option, but of course, if you are in a very strong situation on these kind of people, do something different, but not show a brain. So this is an extreme, so try to do something different. For example, starting with a picture, or starting with a video, or showing something. For example, for me, it's very easy to explain prosody with chords. And, well, it's easy because it's the way in which you can understand it better. Okay, so, but even when you are in your discipline, probably you never have someone who knows the same as you. You are the specialist. And you have to try to be simple. And if this object, of course, you have never do something that is completely unrelated to your research. If I go do this now, I don't know, this exercise, why are you doing that? I don't know, it's just to catch the attention. No, something related to, okay? If I have to go to a Chino shop to buy this object to show you or to understand you how attention works, it's fine. I'm not competent for that, no. I'm just trying to show you. I do an effort for you, and you know it, because this is the proof. So if I were you, I would be very happy in this sense. Oh, well, this is like, well, you are doing something for people, or you are just here just talking and talking because you have to talk about your research and that's it. Or you are doing that and trying to move for action and trying to people wake up. This is an effort. I'm really tired now, but this is my job. But this, if I'm here just doing nothing, it's nothing. So your work is for nothing. And my experience is that when you do something outstanding in your presentation, people will remember you. And probably all the questions will drive to you. And probably, this guy in the presentation, because this happens in all the conferences. The problem of us is that we are, well, a little bit shy. And, well, and because everyone is shy, we have these presentations everywhere. And this is not a... So just measure the level of, I don't know, outstanding that you are doing. So maybe if the audience is, it's hard, so try to do something a little bit, and if you have all the audience here, like in this competition, for example, or, I don't know, tech talks or these kind of things, try to do something different. If it's related to your research and is showing something interesting of your research, no problem. There will be no problem, no problem about that. And people remember you. This is really important. Okay, so record to your grandmother to do it. Okay. What else? This Emil, this student.
Some of you might recognize this building, but for those of you who don't.
Let me put again. I would like to you to pay attention to the way in which she introduced the problem and the solution. In 1 minute.
Some of you might recognize this building, but for those of you who don't, this is what the hub is projected to look like at the end of this school year. So the hub construction project has been going on since the summer of 2013. The new building is said to include new seating space, a Thon merchandise store, a renovated food court and bookstore, a green roof, as well as just a more convenient relocation of the venues that are inside. So awesome, right? We're all for this project, except for one problem. It's already been in the works for over a year. So we constantly have to change our paths due to blocked off walkways, and we're visibly and audibly bombarded every time we pass the hub. And this year's sophomores didn't get a chance to experience the hub lawn like they should have. This is just one example of how construction takes way too long of a time, not to mention the fact that it's one of the most dangerous jobs there is for workers. My name is Amelad El-Karim. I'm in engineering science and math here at Penn State.
Okay, 1 minute, just the problem. In 1 minute. Here we have other problem. Easy. So you can do it in 1 minute. It's easy. Right? And here we have another example, but I will let you to pay attention to the example.
Of the over 500,000 hip replacements done in the past year in the United States, 60,000 of them have been revisions, redos, mess-ups and mistakes that could have been avoided if the orthopedic surgeons and the people developing those medical materials had worked more closely to make biomaterials that are safer for our patients. My grandmother is one of those 60,000 people who had to have her hip recalled, and the fact that her health was put at risk because of a
is clear. He uses his mother, is very clear. She has a problem, and I have the solution, okay, for this. Development is easy, how to get the solution, okay? So this is the beginning. At the beginning, remember, first something different, and then problem and solution, okay? Here we have a problem. Here I can hear about methodology. What is your methodology? If your framework is easy to understand, you can mention it. If not, don't do it, because it's really complicated and I don't understand. Okay, but it's important, the methodology, participants, stimuli, variables, okay? Even when you don't have the results, but you have a methodology or not. You must have a methodology or not. So you can just explain, well, I selected 100 participants to listen to some radio commercials, and the idea is to measure the variables of, I don't know, attention, memory, and engagement, I don't know, whatever. And then what I'm going to do is to put these, guys to see something, whatever, displaying the procedure. And in the procedure, you can explain methodology and the variables, and that's it, okay? You have all these methods to write the development. I'll give it to you, so, but you just read it. Are they clear? Analytic, descriptive, comparative, sequential, inductive, deductive, problem. This is our goal here. Causes, consequences, progressive, and logic. So you have to think what is the better for your research. Steve Jobs. You know, have you heard the discourse of Steve Jobs in Stanford? It's really famous. And what happened there? It's very famous. It's a discourse, and he started saying, well, I'm going to tell you three stories. And it's one story, second story, a third story. That's it. And there are stories about his family or, I don't know, something personal, okay? So he's very famous. It's an old technique. It's a really old technique. For me, it's not a good presentation, because there's nothing new. It's just three stories. Storytelling is really old, so you can use a story. This discourse is famous, first, because he was ill in this moment, and second, because it's Steve Jobs. That's it, but not for the discourse, because it's three stories. This is the structure, nothing else. Okay, you can use this resource. It's really, well, it works. So if you tell a story, use your mother, use your grandmother, it's really, okay, it's emotional. It's emotional. I have heart here. So think about it. Not just the brain. And at the end, conclusion, really easy. Summarize in one sentence and a final statement, a strong closing. Okay. Let me just, let's take a break. But one thing, in the conclusion is the same, okay? You can do something relevant as well. If you start with an object, you can end with the same object or with the same statement or saying, well, the solution was, I don't know. You can do many things, okay? But what is important after that, you have to write everything, you know? And the outline form that I gave you is, this is the function. So you just take now the outline form and start writing. From the good afternoon or good morning, and then everything, word by word. Because if not, it's impossible to control the time, many things. To do something logical, to structure your ideas, to find the vocabulary. You know, the competition last year was in English, Spanish, or Catalan. My idea this year is just in English. Research is in English, I'm sorry. So we have to do it in English, and we have to, it's the language of science. So precisely for that reason, you have to write every word, check that expressions, check grammar.
Yes, we can.
Yeah, but someone, when a group of researchers in the States did the same research that I did 20 years ago in my doctoral dissertation, exactly the same, and radios and television called me 5 years ago as a specialist in voice prosody, to tell me, well, what's your opinion about this research? I say, oh my gosh, but I did that, but I did it in Spanish. So it's for nothing. I'm sorry. This is in English, and it's whoa. And someone in this moment, it was like, I was feeling really bad because, well, it's my it's the same research, but my research is published in Spanish, and nobody knows about that. And someone told me, well, I'm sorry, you are doing divulgation, and they are doing research. I say, what? What are you telling me that? This is really strong. This is really hard. But yeah, it's really hard because I think that science could be done in all the languages. Why I have to do it just in English? But now the world is that. And if you are in this world trying to publish in top journals, and believe me, this is your goal in the future, these are the rules. So, first from the beginning, I just have to do that after 20 years of researching. So if you can do from the beginning, it's better, believe me. But try to do it in English. And probably you have to go to many conferences in Europe and I don't know, is in English. So. I can do that. I can, okay, so important, and let's take a break. Very important, this is the structure, okay? We have a beginning, a development, and at the end, the conclusion. But now we have to join these parts, okay? And to do that, we have to use transitions, because if not, we have a research showing that if you don't use transitions, to give coherence to the text, to your discourse, people won't understand anything. So this is important. So mark with transitions, mark with this kind of expressions, your discourse. To start off, let's move now on to the next point, and whatever. Or to recap, to sum up at the end. But also, you have to give coherence, internal coherence, not just external. So you have to use inside the text these other transitions. However, consequently, you know, in blue, for example, okay, so mark the main part of the discourse with the external transitions, and then inside of each part, you have to use these transitions. Consequently, people understand things when you are guiding, and guiding, please, another assistant. Guiding means this is, show. What? Show that. This is the first table, and then we have the second table, and then we have the third table. So one, two, three. Or what is the beginning? What is the beginning? I don't know. The beginning of this, I don't know, is this, and the other is. To mark things, I have to guide you. Or this happens because the cause is I don't know what, and then I have consequences. Oh, easy, logical, okay? I'll give you a lot, so don't worry about that, because we have additive transitions, we have adversative transition, we have a lot. So, I'll give you, so just take it when you are writing, you can use it, okay? Let's take a break, but what I would like you to do now is to go to take the break in couples, okay, with a colleague. And we have the outline forms there, so take your outline form and go to your couple to take a coffee or whatever. And try to explain the introduction, just the introduction, problem, contribution, in 1 minute. Just in 1 minute. You can use the timer of your phone or whatever, okay? So take the outline form, and we have 15 minutes. Till 3, okay? So let's go. Okay, let's go again. Okay, let's go. How was your introduction in 1 minute? It was okay or not? Yes or not? Someone can, would you like to come here and explain to all of us your introduction? Someone can do it? No? Let me... I don't know. I don't remember your name. Lara. Lara and your colleague. Where is your colleague? It's not here. Okay, it's the same. We, all of us are your colleagues, so don't worry. Start like the first time outside. Like the first time. In the podium, please. Just one example, very fast.
So I study human population genetics. Basically, we are interested in North Africa. So what we do is we go there, take blood samples from people.
Time out. okay. Problem? Okay. Again. The other version.
The other one? Okay. We study human population genetics, and we are interested in North Africa because there is little known about that region, and it is known by historical records, but sometimes this is biased, so we need some more information about that region.
Stop. Problem? Okay. We don't have many information about these tubes in Africa, so need more. Okay. She's improvising, please. An applause, because. But second thing, second version is what I have to, in this outline, okay, form. The problem is the most important. Engage people, think about your mother, and think, well, how can I start? What my mother knows about that? What is the problem? This is really important, okay? So think about that. Thank you, Lara. Second time here, so. This outline form is for you, okay? It's a way to work in the future for all your presentations. My advice is fill out the form before start preparing your presentation, because it's a way to clarify your ideas, okay? What is the problem, and answer the question, because you didn't answer the question. The problem is not, my goal in this research is, no, this is your goal, this is not your problem. So we have a problem, okay? So what is the problem, what is the solution, what is your contribution? Why are you doing here, why this research is completely different from the rest? What are you, your contribution? When you are writing a paper, this is a key point. It states the dissertation, has the first part is just the summary at the beginning, and then the table of contents. The next one is the contribution in the state. So it's important, the contribution, but here in Spain we always forget it. Contribution is the same. No, it's not the same, especially if you are trying to get funds and whatever. So be clear with that. So it's a document to work in the future, okay? If someone can need help about that, when I finish, when I end the three classes, feel free to email me, and if you want, we can go to take a coffee, something, to have a coffee and talk about that. I can help you if you want with some part of this outline form, but here is impossible because we have just limited time, so, okay? Language. What kind of language we have to use? You say, well, English, words, language. Verba vola and scripta manen. What does it mean? Latin, please. Nobody. Words are flying. And yeah, this is really important. Repeat it again, please.
Words are forgotten, but writing remains.
Because it's written, okay? But words are, I promise you. What do you promise me? Okay. Oral communication is completely different from written communication, and this is really important. It's not the same to write or to talk. It's completely different. So what characteristics do you think that communication has, oral communication? Characteristics different from written communication. Depending on content, but on context. Immediate. Now, I'm talking. If you lose my words, I'm sorry. It's ephemeral. So you have to repeat and repeat and repeat and repeat. This is really important, okay? Can you see this text? It's a scientist text. What do you think? This is a universal expression. It's the same, the language. What happened with this text? Because the presenter said that in this way. The present state of atomic theory is characterized by the fact that we not only believe. What happened? Is what? It's not simple. More. Introduction, nothing. But language. I'm now focusing on the language. It's complex. Hard. But why is hard? Why is complex? It's written, but even if it's written, it's really, it's really hard. Very long sentences, okay. Concrete things, very long sentences. And in Spanish, in Catalan, and French, we write with very long sentences. But please, if you are preparing a paper for a journal in English, don't forget that. Bear this in mind. For them, it's just subject, verb, and predicate, and stop. They can process this more than that. So this is completely, this is really complicated. Short sentences. No more than 15 words. Especially if it's oral communication, no more than 15 words. And the main idea here is that one idea equals one sentence, okay? So, I look for Mary at the bus station. Easy? Is easy? Mm-mm. The second one, no. We have a lot of ideas there. So I'm completely lost. No. First one. So one other thing that I'd like you to pay attention. This text, every sentence in this text are already long, of course, but every sentence is given new information. It's given to you new information. And nobody talks in this way. Tales of Mary, a typical conversation with my mom.
So the last time I was home visiting my parents, I was hanging around in the kitchen with my mom, and she said, "I just made some fish. Would you like some fish?" And I said, "No thanks, Mom, I don't like fish." And she said, "You don't like fish?" And I said, "No, Mom, I don't like fish." And she said, "This is tuna fish." And I said, "I know, Mom, but I don't like fish." And she said, "I mixed some chopped celery in there so it has a little crunch to it." And I said, "No thanks, Mom, I don't like fish." And she said, "You know, fish is really healthy." And I said, "I know, Mom, but I don't like it." And she said, "All the healthiest people eat fish." And I said, "I know, Mom." And she said, "In fact, I think the healthiest people eat more fish than they do beef or chicken." And I said, "I know, Mom, but I don't like fish."
This is the way in which we speak in general. Well, this is a stream, but this is the way. So when we talk, we give to our listeners given information and new information, but never we give new information in any sentence. This is a very, very important and basic rule of oral communication. So in this case, researchers have been examining the way people choose where to sit in a library. What in the first sentence is given information and what is new information? This is the sound effect. What is new information and what is given information? What is the most important thing in the first sentence? What is the information that you need? In other words, the way people choose where to sit in a library, okay? And in the second one? By the other people in the room. Perfect. So in blue, given information, in red, new information. And this is the way to structure sentences. This is why you have to write everything, to think in these kind of things. So this is the principle, given before new information. This principle is called this way, and it works. So I have to give you the given information before the new. And why is the principle of N weight? Why is called the principle of N weight? We put the main information at the end. Why? Because again, the thing that I have to do at the beginning is get your attention. And then when I have your attention, I give you the main information. This is the way in which language works. So please pay attention to that. Well, do you know, the other day, well, I don't know, I can explain you, but the other day, what happened was, oh my gosh, what I'm doing now? What am I doing? I need your attention first. And when I notice that you are paying me attention, then I give you the information. Then I'm sorry, I don't know, something important after that. This is the way in which attention works. First, I have to get the attention, have to give you the main information. For example, who can reward this sentence in this way with this principle? Do you have an advantage? You. So, what is the main information here? I'll give you. Better? What the police did first was, and now is the most important thing, to interview all the witnesses to the accident. Other example, this is easy. Rewrite it. There is a famous song saying, "All I want for Christmas is you." No, it's a new quote in this case. All I want for Christmas, pause, tin-tin-tin-tin-tin-tin, is a new goat. If I write these sentences in this way, prosody is with me, because it's easy. Pause before the main important thing, and then the most important thing. And this is the way in which comprehension is improved. Okay? Mary works harder than anybody else in this organization. Who works harder? Person who works harder than anybody else in this organization, boss, is Mary. Other resources. Prosody is one of the most important elements in speech. But you are wondering what prosody is? Yes, I got your attention now. Why? Because I have a question, and I change the rhythm. But if you don't write the sentence in this way, I can change. I can play with my voice and do this kind of pauses and this kind of strategies. Okay. So, well, I was wondering what prosody is, and it changed. I changed my volume, my intensity, my whatever, and then, well, it's hard to define. Stop. Not now. And now, well, intonation can be defined as. So I prepared you during all this time to know what is. Now, but if I start the sentence saying, or the presentation saying, prosody is the no idea after that. Do you know what I mean? So, an example. Have you experienced sometimes when you are listening to the radio, for example, and say, well, 200 people died in an accident, very strong accident, in, where do you come from? Barcelona City? In Barcelona. When she pay attention? When I say Barcelona, but I lost all the information. All the main information is lost. So this is not the way in which I have to give you the information. Okay? Got it? Yeah? Main reasons why these chemical substances do not work are? So write the sentences in this way. Okay? Use positive expression, affirmative expression. Use, please, vary the sentence like I did. Interrogative, exclamative, declarative sentences. Don't use subordinate clauses. Subject, verb, predicate, and stop. 15 words, a sentence, one idea, one sentence, stop. Specific language, visual language. It's easy when you are trying to describe something and try that listener imagine in his or her brain what you are saying. So try to use these visual image images to create visual images in the brain of the listener. Short words. There are a lot of, I'm not here to explain all the studies that are saying or showing that positive expression are better for comprehension or whatever. But believe me, short words is one of the, it's a basic in psychology. An active voice, no passive voice. Never use a long word when a short will we do. Very important. Attention with numbers, especially in economy. You. Of course, probably your public is, well, is used to listen to all these numbers, but nobody understands numbers. Believe me, nobody. You will tell me that 1,000 and I don't know. No. So run numbers or use comparisons, always. This, I don't know, this number is like a big, I don't know, a big screen or a big table or, I don't know, something, compare. Be careful with adverbs because there are long words, very long words, probably they don't, its meaning is not important. I use this kind of resource, you know, when you are talking and take this long adverb. And it's just to think the next thing that I have to say, you know what I mean? So, but there are not good words, adverbs. And pronouns as well, sorry. Pronouns as well. Repeat the subject. Repeat in any sentence, repeat the subject. I don't know what the subject is when you are talking. Okay, resources. I'm going to go fast here because I'll give you, so don't worry, but you have a lot of resources to use. Repetition. Redundancy and repetition is basic in oral communication as well. So this is a discourse of Winston Churchill. We shall fight, we shall fight, we shall fight. Very easy.
Well, I say to them tonight, there is not a liberal America and a conservative America. There is the United States of America.
Clear. Not one, not the other. This is the United States of America. The gestures are very important. Okay. Anadiplosis is a repetition of the last word and start the next sentence with this word. For example, isolated and isolation on insecurity and insecurity is the same, suspicion and fear. These kind of things are good to maintain for comprehension especially. Anaphora is the same, repetition, look at Berlin, look at Berlin, look at Berlin. This is Barack Obama. Again.
We are one people, all of us pledging allegiance to the stars and stripes, all of us defending the United States of America.
All of us, all of us, all of us. Okay. Climatic order, we're increasing the climas, we are ascending order, we have an ascending order.
It's the hope of slaves sitting around a fire singing freedom songs. The hope of immigrants setting out for distant shores.
The hope
of a young naval lieutenant bravely patrolling the Mekong Delta. The hope of a mill worker's son who dares to defy the odds. The hope of a skinny kid with a funny name who believes that America has a place for him too.
Increasing the intensity, increasing the pace
of difficulty. Hope in the face of uncertainty.
Hope. Opposition, John Fitzgerald Kennedy, a great and good president, a believer, a fighter, the same structure, okay? Analogy, something is like something. Conduplication is the same as repetition of a keyword. So you can use a keyword or a key expression during your presentation. For example, this is very typical.
It was a creed written into the founding documents that declared the destiny of the nation. Yes, we can.
Yes, we can. So you can use an expression like that, or I don't know. Examples. You have to use a lot of examples. Metaphors as well. Parallelism. You know what it is. Personification. This is really important. The heart of America is heavy, the spirit of America.
My parents shared not only an improbable love, they shared an abiding faith in the possibilities of this nation. I stand here knowing that my story is part of the larger American story, that I owe a debt to all of those who came before me, and that in no other country on earth is my story even possible.
Emotion, this is directly to the heart for you. Okay, rhetorical question, you know, this is easy. A strong sentence at the end. Quotations, you can use it. You are researchers, so you have a lot. Simile, like something. Well, you have a lot of resources. Also, descriptions. Descriptions are very important in order for visual images of people. Okay, so descriptions, and that's the end. So finally, we have the content. We know that the content should be simple, and you have to give a clear structure. Mousy, I think that it had something to say.
Hi again, I'm here to help you. This is what you have to remember about this class. First, plan your presentation. Choose a part of your research. Select a part of your research which is the most interesting and attractive, the easiest to understand. So think about your mother. Fill out the outline form you have. and gather all the resources you have about this part. Okay, second step, write your presentation. Take the outline form and start developing it. Divide your page in three main parts, the introduction, the development, and the conclusion. Use external transitions to present these parts. Prepare the introduction. It's just 1 minute or 1 minute and a half, you know? Choose a surprising attention getter. Explain what the problem is and why this problem is interesting and affects people. Explain what is your solution and mention the goal of your research. Second, prepare the development, about 3 minutes. Select the information you will use, especially the methodology, participants, stimuli, variables, design, or your research. Structure the information. Choose a method to do it. And the last step, prepare the conclusion, about just 30 seconds. Summarize your work in one sentence. Close with a strong statement. And use internal transitions to connect the different sentences. And finally, while you are writing your presentation, use short and simple sentences. Just one idea, one sentence. Positive expressions. Visual language, specific and short words, active voice, and no subordinate clauses. No. Prepare the audience for the main information. And the key thing here is, be careful with numbers, adverbs, and pronouns, and use rhetorical devices, especially redundancy and repetition. Especially redundancy and repetition. And don't forget emotions, because I'm really cute. That's it. See you next week.
Okay, bye. Here you can take your handout for today. You have the everything here, so don't worry. And I will send you all the information, but at the end of the course, okay? But for today, this is your handout, so take it. And next week, voice and gestures, okay? Just voice and gestures. Okay. Well, mousy, poor.